Listening Library presents The Wish House by Celia Rees. Read for you by Christopher Cazenove. You are invited to the opening of an exhibit by Clio, Dalton. Art Bleeds Art. Mixed Media. Thursday, June the 10th, 1982, 6 to 8 p.m. Sponsored by Charles Hammond at Gallery X, 5 Darby Street, Soho. Admission with invitation only. Admits 2. The Summer of the Wish House. Richard still thought about it like that, in stand-out large letters, capitalized in his mind. Title to a very special time. The end of his childhood. Richard had been 15 that summer, a good enough age to begin being an adult. But maybe the transition from one stage of life to another was marked not by your age, but by some event. Like the first time you did something. First drink, first smoke, first toke, first real kiss, first true love, first sex, first death. There had been those, and more. Good enough reason to stop being a child. That's if childhood ends at all. Some people don't think that it does. They think that the child stays curled up inside us forever. Richard left the Tottenham Court Road station and began making his way into Soho. He took the creased invitation from his pocket to check the map on the back. He thought that he knew Soho pretty well, but it was easy to get confused in the maze of little streets. He turned the card in his hands and looked at the street signs, reorienting himself before he set off again, more confident now. He stuffed the invitation back into his pocket again and continued examining his thoughts, turning them around in his mind, handling them delicately, amazed that they were even coming to him at all. Shutting them down had become automatic. He approached the gallery slowly, head down, shoulders hunched, hands bunched in his pockets. He ducked into a little alley across the street. He didn't want to go into the goldfish bowl world he could see through the big gallery window just yet. He knew he would have to, though. He was here to make sure. The child inside him did not sleep secure. He watched the people weaving like fish through and around each other and past the various little plinths and columns, pausing momentarily in front of one piece before moving on to the next. He willed himself not to look for her, but he picked her out easily in the restless melee of punks, goths, and swaggering new romantics. Many of the people around her had their hair in spikes, or flossed out and dyed purple, pink, or blue. She'd had her hair cut to chin length since the last time he saw her, but it still fell straight and swung as she turned her head, as black and shiny as licorice strips. She looks much older, but he supposed he did too. She was thin. The high-laced work boots looked heavy on her slender legs, but she was full-breasted like her mother. Her body looked frail and womanly at the same time inside the retro dress with the deliberate tears around the hem and at the shoulder. Some of the sweetness had gone from her face. The cheekbones were more prominent. Her full lips painted a deep purple, her violet eyes made huge by mascara and thick black liner. He approached the gallery apprehensively, crossing the narrow street with something like fear. Why had she invited him? What was she after? At the curb, his footsteps faltered. Surely he was mad to come here, crazy, like tearing at a wound almost healed. Why open himself to further injury? It had been 6 years since he had seen her. That last encounter came back as vividly as if it had only just happened. The cold rain falling down, the strong, scorched smell of earth after a long drought, the things that he'd done, the way he'd gotten it all so wrong, the hideous embarrassment. At the door now, he nearly turned back, convinced that even after all this time, he still could not face her. And there were things she didn't know. Things he would have to tell her. All his thinking, all his planning had not prepared him for her actually being this close. It was like a sudden blow aimed at the very center of him. He felt it go through him, tingling down his legs and up into his chest, a physical pain that left him lightheaded. There was more to it than just his guilt. He could sense her power, her magic, even through the thick plate glass. He was caught by it again, and the fear left him cold and shivering, despite the oppressive evening heat. Maybe he never would recover. Maybe she was in his blood forever, a fever that would recur and recur throughout his life, like malaria. Maybe that's what her father had meant. He could almost hear Jay's voice, a growling whisper deep in his ear. Go, boy. Get away while you still can. You don't have to do this. He took a step back, as though he'd never intended to go in anyway. But he kept watching her through the window. Jay's voice came again, now with a jeering laugh. Don't say that I didn't warn you. She blended with the people circling around her, an art student just out of college. But she was not really like the rest of them. There was a notoriety about her. Hers was the kind of story people liked to repeat to each other. Her father, J.A. Dalton, the well-known artist, not exactly a national treasure, but not far from it. His bizarre death, so sudden, all those paintings, all that money, and her so young. Richard remembered his shock upon reading the details of the inquest. He'd followed the story in private, buying his own newspaper, locking himself in the bathroom to read it. The names, the facts, the circumstances had leaped out at him from the pages. A worst dread realized. A nightmare come true. Actually seeing it all set out had made it real in a way it hadn't been before. He'd gripped the paper, scanning the columns, his fingers printing the pages with dampness. Even now it made his stomach churn to recall it. He'd been astounded by the final verdict. Death by misadventure. Weird people do weird things. That's what the coroner seemed to suggest. They thought it was an accident, but Richard felt guilty even now, as though it had all been his fault somehow. What if her brother, Joe, was here? Or her mother, Lucia? What he should really do was walk on down the street without looking back. He stared up at the gallery front. It had been a shop until recently. The original sign, Grisham & Sons, Tailoring and Men's Attire, showed faint below the silver-on-white Gallery X design. Across the road, lurid neon winked on and off above an adult bookshop. The area was scruffy but full of character, cool and alternative. Up and coming, but still dodgy enough to retain street creds. It figured that she would pick a place like that. It was a private viewing, but for once he wouldn't have to bluff his way past the guy at the door. He held up the invitation, which his mother had forwarded to him. He wondered how Clio had even known his parents' address. He didn't remember ever giving it to her. But if she wanted it, she'd find it. She was that kind of girl. She must have gone to some trouble to get it. That thought made his nerves tingle even more. In the gallery, he blended into the crowd. Not all her art student friends were punks, and he was just another guy dressed in black, his long hair tied back. She was standing deep in conversation with a group of people. As he came in, she looked up, and for a second their eyes met. She nodded and gave a wide smile that made his heart jump. She mouthed something he couldn't hear, her teeth very white against the purple lipstick, her big eyes bright and slightly mocking. Richard remembered that look very well. She was detaching herself from the group she'd been with, moving toward him through the crowded room, causing him to search frantically through his mind for one of the phrases he had prepared. He was all set to stammer out the words when someone took her arm, steering her away from him. She turned her head, pouting her lips as if blowing him a kiss, her mouth shaping what he thought might be later, and ciao, Ricardo. Ricardo. No one had called him that since that summer. Richard felt suddenly weak. He looked around for a wall, somewhere to lean, and found some stairs that seemed to lead up to nowhere. He had to get a hold of himself. He sat down and opened his program with shaking fingers. This exhibit is not an exhibit in the accepted sense. The exhibit is the work, an installation that has to be viewed as a whole concept within its space. Richard read on, retreating to his fallback position, the one he'd worked out in case she completely ignored him. He had a way of distancing himself. He wanted to be a journalist after he finished his degree.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.